Hey folks, Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man, at your services. How are you all?
Hope you're doing very well.
Kilt-Man, are you a bit overdressed for sitting in the kitchen doing a video? Yes, I am, but there's a reason for that, because literally, I had just done about 10 minutes of video for you guys outside. Yes, I was doing an atmospheric outside broadcast. Everything was set up, the lighting was great. Behind me, you'd have seen the trees swaying in the garden. You'd have seen workshed. You'd have seen that silhouetted behind me as well. Very atmospheric, very moody. And yes, I got a few minutes into it. Waffle, waffle, talk, talk, yakety yak, don't talk back. And then the heavens opened. Oh, don't worry, it'll just be a slight dampening, you know, to add some more atmospherics. No, the heavens deposited a huge watery payload all over me. As you can no doubt now tell. So, I have retreated indoors. And it's nowhere near as atmospheric, I'll be honest. But don't worry, don't worry. I'll do some stuff out there. Now, what it is, as the title would suggest, I'm going to talk about something that I have now become rather obsessed with. And that's a little bit distressing in its own way. Now, The Shining, Stanley Kubrick's 1980 interpretation of Stephen King's novel, The Shining. I did discuss it slightly before in a previous video, and I have discussed it many times previously, of course, but I played it as part of my Halloween 2020 horrorthon in the final, like, the third night lineup, and it worked this peculiar, bewitching magic all over again. I adore the movie. You're hearing Wendy Carlos's awesomely brooding and sepulchral interpretation of the Dies Irae Gregorian chant, which is the main theme to Kubrick's The Shining, over those dizzying, vertigo-inducing camera shots as Jack is driving through the mountains to go for his interview. Oh, it's fabulous stuff. Anyway. The axe that he uses, Here's Johnny! That entire final act, with the it's a fire axe. It's a fireman's axe. And the actual one, you know, this is the thing, I want that axe, and that axe does exist. It's a real axe. It wasn't made for the movie, it wasn't modified. The prop department went out and bought that axe, and it was literally 31 inches long of hickory wooden stave with your steel, you know, axe head and a pick on one side. Not too dissimilar to this, just a bit bigger than this. This is actually even older than the axe used in the film. This is a fireman's axe hatchet version, aka a tomahawk. They do call them tomahawks. And this is very, very old. This was in my mum and dad's house, big kilt mama and big kilt papa's house when I was growing up. Yeah, this was there then. And I'm 51 years old. So that's some vintage on this. Fair bit of rust as well, as you can tell, but it works. It's very, very resistant, hard, and it's not sharp, but it will do some damage. And that, the pick on the other end, by the way, the pick, the reason why you have them is because you might be chopping through a frozen lake to get someone who's fallen beneath it, or someone who's beneath wreckage and debris, and you can hack into it. The big axe has it too, hack into that and wrench stuff away. Very handy. In the movie, it is just a much bigger version of this with a 31 inch long stave. Now, if you look here as well, this has been forged with the two brackets, and the stave has gone between the two steel brackets and is anchored in there, nice and snug. The one in the film doesn't have those two anchoring brackets. It just literally is fastened onto the top and the stave is banged into it. There you go. Jobs are good. And any bathroom door or hotel door doesn't stand a damn chance. But I have become rather obsessed with getting some stuff from The Shining. Now, as you all know, I do collect props. I do collect, you know, replicas of pretty much everything you can. I try to amass the costumes for various characters. And what I hate about buying replicas is if the real thing exists. I mean, that I don't mean getting that axe. It'd be very hard to get hold of that axe. Because I know what's happened to that. When the film wrapped, a crew member actually bought that axe off the studio. Because he thought, I've got some wood that needs chopping. Well, I'll use that. And that's the one that Jack Nicholson used. But when he took it home, he just put it on the wall. And he didn't use it for chopping any wood. So it remained in pristine condition. And then it was sold at a London auction. A few years ago now. And it fetched 175,000 English pounds, which I think equates to something like 200,000 American dollars. So, you know, someone paid a lot of money for that. And if I had the money, I'd have done it myself. Because it's iconic. It is. I mean, he only kills one person with it, I know, and a couple of doors. But then again, did Grady use it as well? The previous caretaker? Is that the axe that he used to kill his family? Well, almost certainly, because it's Grady that opens the door and lets him out the freezer, isn't it? Or is it? And that's one of the many ambiguities of the movie. But, so what I mean is, they did not make that axe. The prop department went out and bought that axe. That is a genuine axe that existed at a full range. Just took it off, you know, the shelf in a hardware store. Well, that'll do. And it's very similar to a lot of axes that you'd see in hotels and businesses and buildings and, you know, department stores. The fire axe, you know, you break the glass, you get the axe out. Nowadays, if you do see an axe, they're going to be smaller, and they're usually sort of bright red as well, or orange, the kind of emergency colours. Whereas the axe in the movie is just a very pale hickory stave, and a very clean blade on it as well, very clean indeed. So this guy, the crew member, bought it, didn't use it, but loved it, and then sold it. So some collectors got it now. But you can get replica foam, hard foam versions of that. And they look pretty good, they do. Trick or treat, yes, yes, trick or treat. Those guys that make all those masks I've been showing you, or at least a goodly proportion of them, they have got a version of that axe as well, which is taken directly from the actual axe itself. So it's an exact replica of it. And I've seen it, well, I've seen pictures of it. Let's not get ahead of myself here. And for my money, it looks a little bit too clean. The blade itself is too clean. The wood is too clean, the wood effect is too clean. But having just watched the film again, and in fact, just before I went for my abortive attempt to film outside, I watched the pivotal scenes again, closely looking at the axe, and the axe is very clean. So in actual fact, the trick-or-treat replica one, in the pictures at least, looks pretty good. So, and it's only nice and cheap, but this is the vicious irony that I find myself in, that because you can get a replica made out of foam rubber. Yeah, that's all well and good. But yeah, you can still get proper two-handed, long-handled fire axes, you know, with the axe head and the pick. So I'd rather have one of those. So this morning, even though I've had no sleep over the last three nights, I ran out and I went to the hardware stores around here, because there's two just down the road. One appropriate enough called Howl's, especially for Halloween, and one called the Flying Dutchman. Yes, yeah, but so nicely mysterious, aren't they? But of course, dickhead here didn't reckon on the fact that it was Sunday morning. Weren't open, were they? No, they weren't. Because I was really hoping to come back and say, "Look, I've got an axe that's just the same," you know. I've just got this, which is, it's a much smaller version, but I do intend to get one, and I want it to look as near as damn it. If I can find an actual vintage long handled fire axe, then by Jove, I will do so and show it to you. But if all else fails, yeah, I'll get the trick or treat one. There's other companies make it as well. The rather cleverly, humorously titled Rubber Johnnies, they make one which looks pretty good, and there's a blood-stained variant as well. And because don't forget, in the film, poor old Dick Halloran, played by the great Scatman Crothers, who has The Shining, as well as little Danny, played by Danny Lloyd, they both got The Shining, they both got psychic abilities. But Scatman Crothers realises Dick Halloran, who's the chef at the Overlook Hotel, who's because they've all gone at me. It's just Jack Torrance and his wife and his kid who are looking after it for 5 months over the winter period. So he's gone back to Miami, sunny Miami, but realises, no, they're in trouble. So then flies all the way back to Denver and then rents a snowcat and off he goes, ploughing through the mountains to get there just in time to get the business end of this rammed into his chest. What's the use of having all those psychic abilities if you can't see that coming and just like duck, you know, or go in a different door? Or don't walk around shouting, anybody there? Is anybody there? Don't give the game away. Anyway, so the axe only claims one on-screen victim anyway, but it's still an iconic piece of horror mayhem, a tool of terror, without a doubt. So you could always get the prop one, I know. I think another company called Plantation do it. It's Rubber Plantation. They do what? Is that Rubber Johnny's and Rubber Plantation? A whole lot of rubber going on there. And again, they do the same sort of thing. It's a similar sort of look. One's got a straighter stave handle on it, and one's got the more ergonomic sort of curve one, which, like you see here, is a bit more sort of grip and ergonomic proportion to it, so you can wield it a bit better. And with the two-handed one, that's kind of what you want, you know, you want a bit of a curvage to it. But so I'm a bit disappointed that I couldn't get one, but you know, I'm working on it, folks. Is that wrong? I told Mrs. Kilt-Man, darling, light of my life. When I'm working, stay the fuck away from me, you know. When I'm doing my videos, when you hear me and my voice looking at this camera lens, just stay the fuck away, you know. Is that so hard to understand? So, anyway, she's like, well, just get the prop one. Nice and cheap, just get the prop one. But I'm loath to do that. I'll only buy a replica thing if you can't get the real thing. I'll only buy, you know, a make-do jacket if I can't get the actual jacket made for the movie. You know, I have to have as real as damn it. Have to. And that has become a little bit of an obsessive little itch that I'm struggling to scratch at the moment. But there's one out there. Don't you worry, there's one out there. I mean, this is good. I love this. I mean, I've had this for a fair bit myself. But as I say, I kind of grew up with this in the house, and I always liked it. I always thought it was a tomahawk, and you know, they are referred to as tomahawks as well, these fire axes. And you know, they're widely seen on American shores, but they're hugely seen, well, they were seen in the UK as well. I think alloy handles now, and they're very, you know, tensile and all this sort of stuff. Different materials, far more lightweight, and day glow as well. But this, you know, this is old school, and there's no school like the old school. So I was also looking at getting a burgundy russet red corduroy trucker's jacket. So I thought, well, yeah, should be able to get one of those. I've always sourced, you know, jackets and clothing which is identical to what you see in the movies. I've always managed to do that. And of course, I found one. Oh, that looks a bit like it, but it's not quite right. Jacket, you know, Jack's jacket. And then, you know, something similar, perhaps. Oh, that's called the Overlook Hotel. What? Oh, that actually is a replica jacket of Jack's jacket from the movie. So they do exist. You can get them, and they're a little bit pricey. Me thinks I'm going to get one. Oh yeah. So the axe and the jacket, and but my version of Jack will be in a kilt. It'll be Jack McTorrance, and it won't be the Shining. It'll be the Kilting. But yeah, I think it'd be great. So I've got some more stuff from the Shining to show you, but I'll do that maybe later on. But yeah. Oh. There's another axe here. I'll just show you this while we're in that kind of mood. There's another axe. That is the Frankish fighting/throwing axe. Sometimes these staves are curved as well. This one isn't. But the real magic of this is the way that this blade is designed, because this is meant to be thrown and it can bounce as well and still hit the target. Yes, it's clever, isn't it? It's clever. So even back in those days, the Franks, you know, warring warrior nation that they were, they worked out how to use these things. I've done this on a video as well, so, you know, go back to it, but that is a great bit of kit as well. But you can't exactly see Jack Nicholson wielding this, can you? Well, maybe you can, I don't know, maybe you can. I mean, to be honest, he's got a massive, massive axe there, and he still makes such hard work of those wooden doors, doesn't he? Doesn't he? Yeah. Because you can hack through them with this in half the time. But it's all done for effect. Of course, with Kubrick being, you know, the take after take after take after take, you know, and famously, you know, the baseball bat sequence with poor Shelley Duvall as Wendy, the long-suffering Wendy, and Jack's, you know, pursuing her up the stairs, and she is going to hit him bang on the noggin and knock him down the stairs with the baseball bat. But 81 takes, maybe more. But people on the set, people who know Kubrick, would say, well, it's not quite what you think. People are saying that he's done 81 takes there, and he's a merciless taskmaster, and he gave Shelley Duvall such a terrible time. In actual fact, he did it for everybody. Everyone went take after take after take. But the reason why he does that, or did that, is because he didn't do rehearsals. So basically, your rehearsals are, he's got the camera running. So before certain scenes, you might run through it a good dozen times before the camera starts rolling. All he's doing is making you do your rehearsals with the camera running. So, and another idea as well is that, because you're going to get 1,001 different interpretations of the same scene, and he only wants one. He might not even know what that scene, what that look, that expression, that way of terming a phrase was going to be until it's happened, or until he's gone back and looked through all of them. Oh, that's the one. And people have said it's normally kind of like take 27, 28, that sort of region, where people are getting a bit frustrated. They're tired of doing the same thing. So they've gone from like sedate to completely manic and then back again. And now they're tired, but he still wants more and more and more. So poor Shelley Duvall, you can see her face. Oh God, she's in such a bad state there. But it lends such an impact and such emotion and believability and realism to the sequence. And of course, everyone thinks, well, Jack Nicholson can just nail this. He can play madcap. But what you see in the film of his madcap derangement and obsessiveness and crazy antics and expressions and phrases, he's gone through, you know, at least 100 other variations on that, but those are the ones in the film that Kubrick has picked. So another bit of shining in depth there. Anyway, axes. Oh, he loves them, he does. I mean, I collect swords as well. You've seen the swords, and I've got loads of knives and stuff. And again, I don't like things which are like just cheap copies. I'd rather have, if the thing exists, I want the thing itself. And if not, then I want an official replica. I want the best made replica, you know, that you can possibly get. And if it's it's meant to be steel, well, I don't want foam rubber now, do I? You know what I mean? So, I mean, if I go and get this big two-handed, long-handled axe, then you might see me using it. I might go and chop some wood and see how effective it really is. See how effective I am at doing it. Other movie axes, Evil Dead, Evil Dead 2. Yeah, well, there's no little pick on the back of it, and in publicity shots for Evil Dead and Evil Dead 2, you often see Ash holding a double-headed axe, which he doesn't wield in the movie. Other axes, well, there's axes in Friday the 13th, Jason Voorhees, the big Victor Crowley in Hatchet 1, 2 and 3, he uses a variety of really, really nasty weaponry, but axes definitely figure in there, as well as hatchets, obviously. What else? Oh, there must be 1,001 axes in movies. Because why can't I think of them now? Reanimator, at the end, when lovely Barbara Crampton, you know, is going to be, she's been bitten and chewed and attacked by all the zombies which have been reanimated. And a fella runs down and he smacks the glass and pulls out the fire axe. If I remember rightly, that's bright red though. See what I mean? These safety things, they're always a bright colour. Whereas you don't want that. So, folks, from Kilt-Man, who is currently caretaker of the Overlook Hotel. In the meantime, and that freaky snow-frosted in-between time, please do take it easy. Keep it kilted. Keep it kilted. Kilted. And I'm going to see you all